I'm Holly Constant.
And I'm Maddie Hockaday. We really love Parks and Rec, and we really love behind-the-scenes details.
So we're researching everything from DVD extras like deleted scenes and commentaries,
plus interviewing cast and crew who actually worked on the show.
We also bring on guests and friends to geek out about everything Parks.
So join us, you tropical fish.
This is literally the best Parks and Rec rewatch podcast.
We're your park pals.
There's a park and some pals, and there's also therapy too.
All right, everyone. Hello and welcome.
Hello. A very special treat for you today.
Oh my gosh, what a treat. We have been waiting to get Kirston Mann on our show for quite some time. I don't even know if I told her that we've been waiting forever. I mean, it kind of came across because we just came across so excitable, but
I feel like we're always excitable.
Totally. Oh my God, totally. I swear. I always am like, but I'm always like, am I being too like overzealous? But at the same time, like, I think everyone that we've talked to is so excited about what they do.
Yeah.
She is just a delight to talk to. Very easygoing, I feel, and very, just easy to talk to.
Yeah. And this is absolutely not just a job to her. Like, the way you hear her explain her thought process and everything that she takes into this job, it's just the way she looks at it is beautiful and not how you would really look at the job. So it's going to be quite a treat for you guys.
Yeah, totally. And talking to crew is literally one of my favorite things, because I love talking to actors and obviously we have such a good time with them. Mm-hmm. But it's such a collaborative thing. One thing wouldn't happen without the other. And if no one was there to dress them, then they would not be the same characters. And talking to crew is just like amazing, because you really get to see how the sausage is made and how the process is. I think we got a lot of good questions too about other shows that she's worked on, which was like one of the biggest things that I was interested in, as far as like how she started this job and how she got here to where she is now and like the people that she works with and all those things. So it was really lovely to hear about her story, and then we get into Parks and Rec. But just FYI, like, we do talk about The Good Place, we talk about The Woman in the Window with Kirsten Bell. She's working on Loot right now with Alan Yang. She's also working on something that will come out in the fall that she can't say what it is yet, but we will 100% be able to find that out in the fall. And we will post about it. But if we didn't ask any questions that you wanted to hear, I'm happy to reach out to her. Obviously, I'm not going to abuse that liberty, but I'm happy to reach out to her again. And I'm sure as the show goes on and we see more costumes, I will reach out to her of my own accord. So, you know, just keep an eye out for that. But yeah, we had a great time and we thank her so much.
Yeah, so, it was a great time. Enjoy, everybody.
Yeah, it was a great time. Yes, enjoy the lovely Kirston Mann. Please rate, review, do all the things. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention the Nashville shooting at Covenant, where 6 humans died, 7 if you count the shooter. It's not over, is what I have to say. Just because it's been more than a week, it's not done. We have a lot of fighting left to do. And by fighting, I mean resistance to what's happening. You can donate. I will post it in our show notes. You can post, you can donate to the families of Covenant. Tennessee also just blocked the drag ban. So that is a little bit of a good news. It's temporary. Again, it's not over. But I will say, you have to take a break sometimes from the doom scrolling and from the rage that you might feel. I was talking to Maddie a little bit about this before. I have never felt such rage at my country until this week. I mean, obviously it's been going on forever, but
when it's close to you, you feel it hits different.
It does hit different. Yeah. Especially on that Monday where I was just so angry. I was like, I don't care about your thoughts and prayers. I don't care about your signs that you're making. It's not changing anything. Mm-hmm. And that was a really negative view. But I don't regret feeling that, because that led me to, you know, the empathy that I feel now. So, and that's just also how I process. Like, I'm not going to apologize for that, and you shouldn't either. So, because you should be angry, and what it's something that I've been learning too. Like, it should not be something that you're moving on to the next news cycle. Mm-hmm. So, the school is literally on the same street as my work, and we saw people coming out of the school And we handed out snacks and water from our office. And yeah, it's just, it's not over. So don't forget it. Don't let it drag you down. And I'm saying that to you guys as much as I'm saying it to myself. But keep following it. Keep following every town. Follow every town. I'm going to tag all these people, but follow every town. Follow Moms Demand Action. Follow the ACLU. For whatever state you're in, ACLU Tennessee is one, ACLU, any state. It's ACLU underscore and then whatever your state is. They're always doing great work and helping fight back. Look at your local, like if you can't or if don't have the energy to call your local government officials or whatever, you can donate if that helps. But something that I did over the weekend was volunteer with the YWCA, and it is so important to see the wins. Because if you don't know or see how you're winning, you will not want to keep going. So just look at what we've done so far and know that it's not over, but your life isn't over either. So you're not fighting against life. You're fighting for life. I'm going to say that again. You're not fighting against life. You're fighting for life. So keep going. And I'm sorry that I'm saying this before Kirston Mann's amazing interview because she's so good and it's actually really lighthearted. I just don't want us to forget what has happened and what is going to continue happening if we do forget. So again, thank you to Kirston. We love you. We thank you. I'll be in touch with you. Thank you. We had some really crazy technical issues, so I'm glad that she stuck it out with us.
Yes, for but. Sure.
Anyways, okay, have a great week. And we love you guys. And here's Kirston Mann.
Enjoy.
Thank you.
There's the Parkinson Pals, and there's also therapy too.
Hi, hi, hi. I've listened to your show a couple of times, and it's so great.
Oh my God. Thank you. No way. Thank
you. That's awesome.
We appreciate it.
I wore, I wore my Parks Crew t-shirt.
Oh, that's perfect. I want that.
I know. That looks so
I know.
Good.
And on the back is all our tour dates and all the whole crew.
Oh my God.
That's awesome.
That's my modeling for the job.
Yes. Oh my God. We love it so much. That's amazing. So are you in LA right now, or you said you were recording something, or?
I am in LA right now. I'm working on a show called Loot.
Oh my God, of course. I have that on my list. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, and it's Alan Yang and Matt Hubbard, who both wrote for Parks and Recreation.
Yes.
And I will say that Parks and Recreation, and it wasn't the first show I ever did. I did a show called United States of Tara, and I've heard Craig Zisk's name mentioned on your show, Craig Zisk and Morgan Sackett.
Yes.
Took me away and I came onto Parks and it changed my life forever because almost everything I do is started, you know, that family tree. Mm.
Totally. Yeah, we were talking about that too, how you are in the Schurverse for sure.
Yeah.
For sure, I am. I am. And I will continue to be, you know, we're going to start a new project in the fall, which is going to be amazing.
Yay. Oh my gosh, I'm looking forward to it. Are you allowed to talk to us about what it is or no? Not yet.
I don't think I can yet. Okay. I don't know. I should have asked him.
That's okay. Do you know where it's going to be on? Like where we can look for it?
That's also probably top secret.
Oh, probably.
But I wonder if it is already mentioned in the trades and I'm just being secretive for no
reason. No, you should be.
Reason.
You know, better safe than sorry.
Absolutely.
We'll know.
Exactly. Believe. Exactly.
We'll
but
find
it's
out.
Going to be amazing and we're going to shoot it this fall. And yes, I continue, you know, I did Brooklynn Nine-Nine, The Good Place, Rutherford Falls, many things with Mike.
Oh my gosh.
He's a dream.
So tell me, what's the first show that you were on again that they pulled you from?
This a show called United States of Tara with Toni Collette, where she plays a woman. Oh, are you both therapists or just one of you?
Maddie is.
Maddie. You have to see it. It's about a woman with multiple personalities, and one of her personalities is a therapist.
Fascinating.
Yeah, it's a very fun show, one of Brie Larson's first shows.
Ooh.
And Craig Ziss came on to direct an episode, and or he might have also been a producer on the show. He is so wonderful, and I would follow him anywhere. And he led me to Parks and Rec, which really became, it's such a, still such a huge part of my life.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, and that's one of our first questions that we always ask guests is how they got their job on Parks. So you really already answered it.
Wow.
But like, how many seasons did you do of the first show of the United States of Tara?
I think we were only on for 3 seasons.
Okay, gotcha. Okay.
And then I was overlapping a bit, which I called out firing between the two shows. But then, I mean, Parks is my heart. It really is.
And it's ours too. Yeah.
I know. It's so exciting to share that with you.
Yes.
It's such a, it's so funny that you two are doing this. I mean, it's amazing for us. And it's so many years later and so many shows later.
It's the gift that keeps on giving, honestly. Yeah, I mean, Maddie was mentioning too about how it should have another resurgence, because I feel like The Office kind of had a resurgence, or not kind of, definitely did have a resurgence, and like everybody was rewatching it and everything. But I don't feel like Parks has gotten there yet. People are, but like it's so niche. It's like a tiny little thing. So I'm so excited that for that eventual happening, because I think it'll be, you know, now that it's on Peacock and everything too.
Yeah. It's funny because I feel like when we finished 5 years later, it popped back up, you know, for my son's generation. Mm-hmm. They were all watching it and wanting, you know, I had a few things like the waffle necklace. And I mean, now I wish I still had them, but anybody who was a fan, I felt like, oh, here you go.
Yeah.
I don't know who has it.
Oh my God.
But like little things that meant something to people like you two.
Yeah.
I would have sent them to you for sure.
Oh my God. That's awesome.
I will say that I took out my Pawnee High yearbook.
No way. What is that?
Oh my God.
Oh my God.
What's inside of that?
Yeah, I've never
seen
that.
Is it an actual yearbook?
Guys, you are so going to want to come to my house.
All those baby pictures.
Anything, baby pictures, crew. All of us, everybody who ever worked on the show, all the characters, because I felt like, how am I going to remember everybody's name and everybody's, you know, of course I do remember, but I haven't seen the show myself. Oh my God. There's where Mike Schur signed my yearbook.
I was going to ask if people signed it. Oh my God.
This is so amazing.
Oh my gosh.
We knew this was going to be a good one. Uh-huh. You are just proving it.
Oh my gosh. Mike was the principal. That was a note from the principal.
He kind of looks like a principal or a math teacher. That kind of pans out.
Totally. He does. I think he'd be very flattered to hear that. He is the best person.
Oh my God. What a
great
thing.
Who wrote the book about how to be a good person, right?
Yes, exactly.
You know that. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes. Oh my God. That's so cool. I still haven't bought that book, but I have read excerpts online and people always talk about it on the podcast. So,
Yeah.
Well, I was going to ask too, like, how did you first get into the wardrobe department? How was this like something that you studied for, or was it like an internship that led to, you know, whatever? Like, what's the story?
What's my story? Well, I was in New York City and I worked in children's books, and I was taking, I was in school for set design. I pictured myself an opera designer or something to design those huge sets. Mm-hmm. And I was in school and I started working as a PA. I started doing craft service. I started doing anything I could in the business, mainly in commercials in New York. And eventually I moved to Los Angeles, and working in the art department is very tough. So if you interview all those people, kudos to them.
Totally.
But I looked over at the costume department and I felt like, wait a minute, I want to do that job instead. I didn't know how to I didn't really know anything about costumes other than the things that we all know, that we all get dressed in the morning.
Right.
But I started working in the costume department and I loved it from the minute I started. The minute I went to Western Costume, I felt like, this is my place. This is my job. I was so excited. My heart was beating and I found my career. And I feel like I look at costuming from a different way. I look at it, you know, more like a painting. If I'm thinking about all the characters on the set, and especially the shows that we do that have big casts, you know, you have to kind of think about how everybody's moving in and out of the set and what, how they are teased apart from each other. And so I feel like I had my own special way of looking at costumes, and that's really helped me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, totally. And as far as like your start though, were you, did you ask someone to like be in the department of the show that you were working on kind of thing, or how did that go?
Oh, that's so interesting. I think I met the costume. No, I do remember. I met the costume designer of the whatever I was working on and just became her assistant.
Okay. Wow. And then worked the way up. Okay.
And worked my way up. And I assisted quite a few amazing people, but very quickly moved up.
Okay. Gotcha. Was fashion always something that you were interested in? Or was it more of like you said, you were just on set and you're like, I want to do that job. I want to know more about that.
You know, more than fashion, characters have always interested me. And I still feel that way. I feel like if I'm people watching, I'm not people watching high fashion. I'm people watching what real people are wearing and, you know, the different ways that real people express themselves. Not, so I don't necessarily have to go to every fashion show. I do love fashion. It's something... Yeah. That's, you know, a little part of my life, but I much prefer wacky people and real people doing, expressing themselves in real ways.
Mm-hmm. I
more
totally
than the latest and greatest. Yeah, I'm sure you do. And that only helps me in shows like Parks and Rec, because that's not about fashion. That's about characters. And, you know, we're not all dressed alike. In fact, real people are dressed more uniquely than the people that are really into the fashion world. They're they're participating in a different atmosphere, a different realm.
Yeah, that is so poignant. I never thought of it that way. Like the character is, and who you are as a character is going to be how you dress. That's so true
and beautiful.
Yeah, it is, and. So that's my favorite thing to do.
Yeah, yeah.
Although on Loot, we just did a fashion episode and it was hilarious and so fun. And it was like fun to tap into that side as well.
Yeah.
You know, but if you have like a 6 foot tall, 120 pound woman, like everything looks fashionable. You can, they could put on anything in my closet and it would look like a runway.
Oh my God.
I mean, and I'm by my closet, my closet is not a runway situation at all.
That's so funny. Well, do you have like the conversations between, is it like a director and you kind of have a conversation about what the show's going to look like? Or is it more of like, you see what the show is and you're like, here's my idea. Do you vibe with it? You know what I mean? What's the collaboration kind of?
So I'll say that you read, usually when you're starting a show, you read the pilot episode. And in my mind, I'm dressing the characters. I don't even maybe know who the actors are yet, but I'm kind of thinking about each person, how they're different from the next person. And then I do go and talk to, so if say, let's say for The Good Place, I went and spoke to Mike and then we kind of talk about all the characters, but the person I care most about is the actor, and doing the fittings is where you really find the character.
Mm-hmm.
So you're putting on different things and you can tell right away when somebody feels like this is it.
Yeah.
You know, some people start saying the lines or some people start, you know, staring at themselves and playing with themselves, like kind of feeling like, oh, I see her, you know, in the mirror. And that's a great feeling for me when that happens. And I mean, I guess it happens often.
Yeah.
And then once you know that, once you've got that, you can really start to have fun with it because you have the base.
Yeah.
Like if I'm saying, looking at the two of you, do you, you know, like what makes you, you?
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah. And reading the pilot would probably be super helpful too, obviously. More than just like an outline of the show. Mm-hmm. I feel like having a pilot would be so much more helpful. Because you started, I think, was it a season three of Parks or season four?
Two.
Oh, two. Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
There midway is like, through two.
Okay,
yes.
Gotcha. Because we're in season four now, because we review each of the shows. Season three for us, I mean, from what we've talked about or can see now that we're like deeply analyzing it, it's like such a shift. And then season four is like, we are raving about every single outfit on there. Like, I just feel as though we're really getting into who these characters are. We were talking a lot about like Maddie, especially me too, but Maddie especially is great at pointing out Anne's costumes.
Love it.
And Anne has been so great now that she's like city public health person and professional cardigan city. And love that.
Yeah. And Leslie is coming into this campaign, right? And we're about to see this shift because she always dresses in these like pantsuits and stuff, but they've always been a little bit like she pays the minimum amount of money for her clothes type vibe. And we're seeing this shift when she starts to run, that like her clothes look a lot sleeker and all the colors match much better. And like all this, it's really cool to see it shift.
The shift. Oh, that's, thank you for that. Because I think when I started, I kind of, you know, you can't just come on as a designer and start, you have to slowly infiltrate your eye. You don't want to throw away everybody's closets.
Yeah.
And you want to make sure that you're always, I mean, I like to operate, I like to think about each person having a closet, just like you and I have a closet, like the three of us all have closets, and that we're pulling from those closets, making different looks. But I like to reuse things. I like to not make it look like every single thing is a new outfit, so that the people, it gives a little bit of reality to the character. But I think by season four, we could kind of clean out the closets. We could make sense that things, we call it retiring. We retired most of what they had started with, and we kind of had tried to give everybody a little bit of a freshen up.
Mm. Yeah, totally. Wait, Maddie, can you ask your question though, that you had about like designing or like
the process.
Goodwill type?
Yeah. Because that was actually one of my other questions was, do you reuse stuff? Because every time I watch TV shows, I'm like, it doesn't make sense to me. They're supposed to be real people. Like, and we don't have a new outfit for every day. Like, right? I mean, I wear this at least 8 times in the winter. So, you know, so that's really cool that you answered that, that you reuse stuff and just made it like a new outfit, which I love. And then my brain was also like, what's the process of, okay, we're going to have this episode and she's going to need these three outfits. Do you like sketch out what you want it to look like? And then does somebody make exactly what you're looking for? Do you go shopping? Like, what is that process?
That is different with every character and every show.
Wow.
And we do all of the above. So a lot of times I'll talk about Parks, since that's what we're talking about. These people definitely had a closet. I had to think about where they would shop. Mm. Do they online shop? You know, I want to make sure it's as authentic as possible and never to make it about the clothes. That's something I try to work on and make it. I want to participate in the storytelling over my own trip about clothing.
Yeah.
So I'm here to be of service to the actors, to make sure that they feel comfortable and in character, and to be in service of the story, to make sure that the writers are getting anything they need from me. So if it needs to be a quick read that Anne is in a different kind of mood or something, I want to facilitate that. And mainly I want to facilitate when it's very real people and very real Midwestern people, I definitely want to make sure that it looks, it might be slightly heightened, but that it looks real.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome.
Is there like a whole wardrobe, warehouse of wardrobes kind of thing that you like go pick out kind of vibe, or, you know, how does that work? Or are you going shopping?
So definitely we go shopping. Definitely we make things also. I didn't answer that. You know, we make a lot of things on Lou, like a lot of Maya's dresses are made, you know, on The Good Place, we made so many of Tahani's dresses.
I was going to ask about Tahani's dresses. Yeah, they're so awesome. Intricate and fabulous. Yeah. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, they are. They're fabulous. And so we make a lot of things, but when it's when we need to, and when it makes sense for the character would have things made. Mm. Although I will say, Amy was pregnant. Amy Leslie Nope was pregnant with Abel during the third season. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if you ever could tell, but, you know, so we made a lot of those suits. We made things that could hide her pregnancy. Mm-hmm. And
there
we tried our best
times, but I mean, the thing we were talking about that one time where it was kind of the style. So I think it was really just, you know, the sign of the times, if you will. But there was these that time in the 2000s, like early 2000s, 2010s, which is when the show was, where it was like there was a cinch right underneath the breasts. Mm-hmm. And so
yes.
And then it's like a flowy thing down
yes.
to the bottom.
Yes. Yes.
And so it's like, and I had those in high school, like, or in college too. Like I had those all the time. So like I feel like, and people definitely could use them as a maternity vibe too.
Yeah. Right, right. And
so it was a great mixture of using yes. both, you know?
Yes, yes, yes. And we definitely used those to cover up her. I think she was the only, I always have a pregnant person on a show.
Yeah.
In fact, at that same time, part of Parks, I was shooting something called Up All Night, and Maya was pregnant with Jack.
Oh my gosh.
So,
Up All Night was the Emily Spivey created that one. Yeah.
Yes, she did. Okay. Yeah, also, yeah. Parks Family.
Yeah, totally. Oh my gosh. Mm-hmm. We just did a whole breakdown on her because she directed mm-hmm. a show in season 3, I think.
So. She is wonderful. I've worked with her many times, and she co-wrote Wine Country.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so good.
Which Amy directed. So we all managed to stay together, you know, for the last 14 years. We have not really been apart.
Yeah, so cool. Do you ever, like, talk to the actors of, or, like, do actors ever have... not suggestions, but are they ever like, this doesn't really feel right? Or do they ever say anything of that nature?
Oh, sure. That, of course, that happens. Yes. Okay. It doesn't happen that often. I think, touch wood, I think I'm very lucky. And I, you know, I'm trying to think, I mainly work with comedians. So we talk on the phone first, and we have such a shorthand. And I will say, I mean, there are people that definitely are pickier or care more about what they look like.
Mm-hmm.
But I love to tell this story about Amy, and it's so, she's pregnant with Abel, and I used to, you know, I was walking up to her trailer and she's like, this looks good, right? And she looked so pregnant. But like, she just didn't care, and she does not want to put on another outfit. And I'm like, no, you look so pregnant. But she has so little vanity. I mean, her thing is not, she wants things to be funny.
Right.
So she cares so much more about the words and what is funny. And she, than she does about what outfit she's wearing. And I think because I do a lot of comedies, it's mostly about being fun.
Mm. Yeah.
You know,
that makes
being fun and being comfortable. Every comedian wants to be comfortable.
Yeah. Yeah, totally.
And every person like me wants to be comfortable. Yes.
I know, totally. Well, especially if you're like, I don't know, if you're trying to focus on the joke like Amy and everybody was trying to do. It's like you don't want to pull too much attention. But I also feel like the balance of that was so well done because there's still some really cool stuff on there. Like Donna's stuff is so cool and like vibrant. And I mean, do you remember if there was a conversation about Donna's clothes at all, or how did that work or anything?
Well, Retta and I would have a lot of fun, and I love her to this day with all my heart. She loves bright colors, so it's very easy. I mean, we just, you know, we would just buy anytime we saw something bright, it was landed in her closet. We had so much fun with her. And actually, I was just thinking, I mean, we often text each other. For her wedding episode, I was crawling under her wedding dress to like fix a piece of tulle or something. And she had her phone and she has a picture of like my head popping out of her giant wedding dress.
That's awesome.
And we'll often send it back and forth to each other just to make each other laugh. You know,
yes. Oh my gosh.
Every few months. Yeah.
Her wedding dress was phenomenal. Mm. How did you do that? Did you design that or did you just find it in a store or a little bit of both?
A little bit of both. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. I'm sure we cut and paste.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to remember, but definitely we did a lot to it, but we probably found the base at a store.
Okay.
If I remember correctly.
Okay. And like, do you get the script like a week before or like way far in advance so you can see this is the storyline that's happening, therefore this is what they're going to be wearing? Like, how does that all work?
That's such a good question. And it's changed over the years. But yes, definitely we have. I mean, we're in production and we are shooting something. We're prepping something. So we'll get the script of the thing. The week that we're shooting, let's say 1, 2, 3, the week that we're shooting one, we're prepping two, and the week, you know, and so on and so on. So you're constantly prepping, wrapping, and then you're wrapping the one before. So say we're shooting two, wrapping one, prepping three.
Got it.
And so you get to keep your brain working. I'll say that.
Yeah.
And when I'm on multiple shows, my brain is really, really working overtime.
Really thinking through it.
But nowadays, more and more people are doing something called crossboarding where you're shooting two and prepping two.
Mm.
So you keep four episodes in your mind and you're wrapping two, which you don't really have to focus on. You just have to kind of make sure that ball is rolling as well.
Gotcha.
And during COVID, I did something with Kristen Bell called The Woman in the House, and we crossboarded all 8 episodes. So we shot 8 episodes at once.
Oh, the Netflix thing, right?
Yeah.
I binged that so fast. Oh my God, that was great.
You okay. did? I oh.
Did. That's a great show.
I love
show.
Kristen Bell
like,
so much.
Such a, oh.
She is the best.
Great She's combination, so too, of, you know, comedy and drama and like weird and goofy.
Yeah. I'm glad you caught the goofy. I was so nervous that people were going to think it was serious. I mean, it's supposed to be a comedy, but
yeah, totally.
They
oh my
played
God.
It so straight. You know, it was.
No, I totally caught it in like her very like housewife suburban moments going on that as far as her wardrobe. Yeah, It nailed it. The vision was there.
The vision was there. And the little, I shouldn't give it away. But more on that later. I don't know if anybody, but anyway, yes. So that, you know, it depends on locations. If you're trying to shoot out a whole location, you are crossboarding a lot of episodes. And that's a lot of work for us, but it makes it easier for the whole production.
Yeah.
Meaning that I'm thinking of the whole unit, which is more like doing a movie, but because it's television, there's a lot more to do, more changes, more, you know.
Totally. Well,
I feel like in a movie, right, usually there can be a couple weeks, but you're not seeing every day of the couple weeks over the movie, right? You're only seeing several outfits. So it's right. like a TV show, you're having at least several outfits in one episode.
Mm-hmm. Right, for sure. positively. There's many more outfits on a TV show.
Yeah.
Totally. And every once in a while, we'll get an episode, you know, say Leslie and Ron are stuck in the bullpen for, you know, that means like my lucky day, one outfit.
Yeah. And I mean, do you work on like you were talking about this too, but I mean, is it often that you're working on multiple shows all at once? You said that you work on a couple shows, but like, I can't even imagine how to keep that straight.
Yeah.
Yes, I have been doing that. And that's because I have an amazing team. And the person who was the costume supervisor on Parks and Rec, Alexis Jacks, shout out to Alexis.
Hey, Alexis.
She's the best. You know, when you have people like Alexis, and I should name so many more people, you know, they're basically helping you keep track, you know, helping you juggle the ball. And when you drop a ball, they pick it up. And so, yes, I have done multiple things for many years, and I'm going to stop. I'm here to say it on the air.
You deserve to.
Thank you. I want to do one thing at a time because you get more of a life.
Yeah.
My son is 23 now, but I just said that same thing to him. I said, I'm going to do one show and I'm going to work less hours. And he's like, yeah, you worked so many hours when I was a kid. And I was like, knife in heart. And then I circled back to him and I was like, he's like, no, you took me to every piano lesson. Don't worry about it. But then he was like, but you were working like 18 hour days. And I was like, but that's not true. It wasn't that many to a kid. I'm sure it felt like that. But,
right. No, but TV hours are insane in general. They are so absurd. Yeah. So, I mean, I totally get it. And Amy Poehler was doing the same thing. I mean, a lot of them had kids and stuff too. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm. I mean, well, and also it's so, Maddie and I talk about this all the time though. When we're so passionate about something, it's already hard enough to say no to the things that you're not passionate about. So to say no/ scale back on the things that you are passionate about, it's one of the hardest things to do. Yeah.
Especially when you don't know it could lead to something else, right? You don't want to miss the opportunity that could be on the other side of saying yes to this one thing.
Yeah.
Right. It's okay. So you're a therapist. I need help with that. But because as you all both know, our family tree grew. So now I'm with Matt and Alan and also still with Mike. Mm-hmm. And I do so many projects with Amy. I mean, I've her movies and mm-hmm. anything that she does, she's one of my best friends. I will never leave her side. You know, so you can't, like, who do you say no to? Because you know, I listened to Mike Trim talk to you too, and you do become family. Mm-hmm. Morgan Sackett is like my brother. I mean, you are family, and doing a show like this. Yeah. Rob Lowe is my brother, guys.
That's so cool. Yeah.
No. And I'm just going to New York at the end of the month to shoot Adam Scott, because he plays Maya's husband in Luke. But we've all known each other for so many years. So it is very hard to say no or to even want to branch out. I'm like, is this going to be the rest of my life?
And
maybe it is.
Yeah. Maybe it is, but also like it's never in your timing. It's always in the universe's timing, which is annoying. So maybe eventually you'll reach to that point where you're like ready to branch out, but could be a lot worse too, which is the stupid thing to say. I know, but like,
no, that's no, I'm kind of joking. I mean, I do other things. I just finished a movie this fall called No Hard Feelings.
Okay.
With the director was Gene Stupnitsky, who I'd never met. So
he worked on The Office a lot.
But he did work on The Office. So we are like distant cousins, but we We run in the same circle. Jennifer Lawrence is in it. I've never met her, but loved her to death. She's such a gorgeous person and hilarious. So I did leave the family for like a group of cousins.
Yeah, there you go.
Right. And that's always nice.
So as long as I keep it in in the gene pool, I think I'm okay. If our DNA matches, I'm in.
I feel like when you're in this industry too, if you found these people who are so genuine and so close to your heart, it's hard to want to branch out in fear of, I'm just putting myself in this position, right? In fear of these people are not going to be genuine. They have the potential to not be what my expectation is from who I've been surrounded by for all these years.
Right. Yes, positively. But you bring your genuine self to the party and you hope that it spreads. Mm-hmm. And I think that works. And I feel like as long as I'm myself and I'm doing, it's good for me. Yeah. It's good for me to do this podcast, to talk to you too. You two ex-college roommates, right?
Yes. So,
you're keeping it in the family too. I see. That's probably why you love Parks.
Yeah. I mean, well, that's what we talk about with every single guest. We're so lucky because they always say, like, don't meet your heroes or whatever. But, like, this show, no one is disappointed.
Yeah.
Everyone, like, and it just shines through so much on the show as far as how, like, well everyone works together. And, I mean, I'm not saying that there probably weren't hard times or whatnot, but when you are family, it's like you go back and forth and, you know, there's always that connection. And it just shines through so well.
So true. And I do think that we've all taken, I mean, Mike is a genius. Mike sure is a genius. Mm-hmm. And he gives you little presents. First of all, he gives you lots of presents. But, you know, I think he gave Nick Offerman such a gift in playing with that character, expanded who he was as a person. I don't want to speak for Nick, but I just feel like he's so cool and great. And I still do Lagavulin commercials with him, you know, and the we all went to Scotland just before COVID. We all are very tight. But I do think that Mike sees something in you and writes to it, and then you get to embrace a part of yourself that's already you, but you get to be that. And I'm not on camera, so he doesn't write a part for me, but I think that his trust in my choices changed everything for me.
Yeah.
I became so much more confident as a costume designer working on Parks with Mike.
That's
and
amazing.
He's very decisive. So, and I feel so trusted. And if I have an idea, like say for The Good Place, Janet's costume, you know, which became her forever costume.
Except for when she played all of the characters, which was gnarly.
Exactly. And so much fun. But I will say, like, when I told him what I was thinking after reading the pilot, he trusted me, said yes, and never needed to talk about it again. You know, we have so much faith in each other.
That's so amazing. And also, I mean, with The Good Place, there is such a vision as far as bright colors, very happy. I mean, obviously you're in heaven, you're supposed to be in heaven.
And, spoiler alert.
It's been out forever, guys.
Yeah.
But I mean, so for that, was that something, you might have already answered it, but I guess I'm just confirming, was that something that Mike was like, this is going to be very bright visually? Or did you see that from the pilot and say, this is our framework? Because from the first episode, you can see it, you know?
We did want it to be bright and poppy. And I'm glad that you noticed. And we wanted it to appear heaven-like. I mean, it's funny because Mike and Drew and probably three other people, Kristen included and Ted, didn't tell anyone that The Good Place was actually not The Good Place.
Wow.
Sorry for anyone who hasn't watched. And
don't be
so
sorry. It's their own fault. Okay.
Okay. Get on it.
Get on it.
But I will say that I kept asking when I read the pilot, Mike and I had our first meeting and I said, it seems like that episode of Twilight Zone where you think you're in heaven and you're actually not. And he was like, nope, he did not give it up for me.
Wow.
And then we were directing the pilot. I mean, I was very obsessed as a kid with that episode of Twilight Zone. And then Drew, who directed our first episode, very sweet, love him. Also, I said the same thing. I was like, seems like hell. And he was like, nope, nobody would give it up. And so, and then they had like a big meeting. I'm sorry to veer off into the good place.
No, I
where
we
they
had that
told
on our list too.
All the actors that they weren't actually in the good place. And I can't remember what which episode. So, and they were all shocked. And I just felt so superior for a minute.
Literally. You are. Well, I mean, I 100%, I mean, maybe it was just my naivete. I don't know. But I did not know until Kirsten Bell literally had that line. I was like, what? Endless frozen yogurt does not seem like hell to me.
No, right? That is our heaven.
Guys, I need ice cream.
Oh my God. There's only one frozen yogurt place here and it's kind of far away and I'm so annoyed because I used to live in LA for a little bit and there was yogurt lands on every corner and I miss it.
Yes. Oh, wait. Now, so where are you now? Where are you two?
I'm in Nashville.
And I'm in Arizona.
And wait, wasn't somebody in Wisconsin at one point? Now you're both. No, I'm
from Illinois. So I've got some Midwest in my in my blood.
In your blood, but now Arizona.
Yes.
Yes.
And we met in Boston.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, and you met in Boston. That's
so
sweet. So
it's all over the country.
Yes. Trickled around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but we definitely, I could swing a cat and hit a, I probably shouldn't say that, and hit a yogurt, and hit a yogurt land. You can't say that anymore, can you?
Yeah, you can, but yeah, I mean, I feel the same way about that saying, kill two birds with one stone. I'm like, there has to be a better way.
Right?
Oh, that's very funny. I'm such a bird fan, and I never think that expression, I never think of it like that. That's very interesting.
I've been saying, it's not going to catch on. I feel like it's like fetch, and it's not going to catch on, but I've been saying, two apples, one arrow.
I'll use it.
Apples. Oh, I like that.
Okay, we're spreading
I'm just
it right now.
We'll make it happen.
Turning around. This one has a broken leg. These came from Amy. Two birds.
Oh, my God. They're so precious.
And guys, right next to it, one stone, but not on purpose.
Oh, that's
how
funny.
The heck?
Wow.
How? Oh, my God. That is amazing. Okay, well, we have to talk about the wedding dress for Leslie.
Oh my gosh.
Because iconic.
It's a dream.
Aww, like dream. Icon. Legend. Star.
Yeah.
So much fun. That's the gift that Mike gave me. That I have to say, he said it was going to be from newspapers and maybe I'm not going to take credit, but maybe I thought that it should be articles about her. And then we kind of made this whole thing and then not that anyone would know. And sewing it together and that it's what she and Anne do together. Mm-hmm. It was so much fun and making those pleats. And it was a lot of the costumes were very arts and craft. And that was one of them where I brought Mike down at least once and showed him how I want it. And my son at the time was very into origami. Hi, Charlie. And we were always making origami, blah, blah, blah. So this was a dream for me. But the way that I wanted to fold the paper was very specific because I'd made a lot of origami hats. And so it all came together miraculously. And I think it looked really good.
Oh, it looked amazing. Absolutely. How did you start though? Like, where did you get the base dress? Was that something that you already had or were you going shopping for that? Or
I did go shopping for a base dress. We cut it apart and we, you know, made our own. So Amy was up there and we were trying to see what kind of bodice would look the best on her. And then we just were trying to figure out. It's not a full base. We really did cut and paste quite a few things, including,
so was there, like,
including the newspaper.
Oh, yeah.
I think definitely. We had some tulle underneath to pop it.
It looks like it.
Yeah.
Like it peeks out.
It was a tulle situation. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it did end up being like newspaper tool. Articles or whatnot of
yes,
her?
All about her.
Oh, my God.
All Leslie, no bar.
Did props, like, actually, or someone, another department that I might not know about, did they actually type up articles about her and for the dress?
Oh, we had the best prop person in the business. I don't know if you've ever spoken to her, Gay Perella.
No, but okay.
She is number one prop person that I've ever worked with. Sorry to all the other prop persons who are amazing prop people. But she's so incredible. She did Mad Men. She's so thorough. I mean, working with her is a dream because she makes everything else look, you know, she wrote all the books, you know, all those book covers, all those, gosh, she'd do things that were inside. She probably made our yearbook.
Oh my gosh.
I bet she did, but she's incredible. And yes, we would have newspaper articles that she would kind of, I mean, she's just the most thorough person. And I think because of her, Mike was able to, you know, we have lots of Easter eggs throughout the season. And you, and I noticed that you two caught a couple that moved from Parks to The Good Place, where we would wink at Parks from The Good Place.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh my God, that's cool. So amazing. And Cones of Dunshire is in like everything that.
Yeah, we're finding cones everywhere. And we're like, why?
Cones are literally everywhere. Like, there was an animated. Oh my gosh, it's a Nick Kroll show, Big Mouth. And Adam Scott did a voice on that. He played a teacher. And they had cones in his room, like in his.
Oh, that's room. So. And I was like, funny.
It's everywhere. And then I think, is it Morgan Sackett who has the production company that's literally called like. Some Dunshire thing or cones of something. I can't remember what it is. I don't know if it's Morgan or Norm. I can't. Somebody has a production company.
Well, Morgan is in partnership with Amy and Kristen. And yeah. he's has a documentary company, Diamond Docs. He's won an Academy Award for a documentary. And he is my brother. Very tall.
Yay.
Brother. Yay. And his wife happens to be my agent.
Oh, wow.
I never wanted an agent in my life. But I love Laura so much. And that she's the only person I would ever have represent me. And so last year I asked her. I felt like I was asking someone to go steady.
I mean, that's basically what it is, that relationship. I mean,
I know. And she's so busy and she, you know, and I also have Lily Fettis Green who works with Laura. So but I did ask Laura and I did feel like that when I talked to her on the phone, I felt like I was on one knee with the biggest diamond I could find in my drawer.
I totally get it. Oh my God. It really is like that. I mean, cause I'm an actor and I have agents and I just recently let one of my theatrical agents go and it was like totally great. Everything was fine. But it just reminded me way more of how it's such a relationship that is so reminiscent of a romantic awkward relationship where you're just like, I'm sad to see us go, but also we have to move on from each other and we have to let each other fly and blah 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 blah. And I'm just like, this is so weird.
So weird.
Because it's not just business. Everybody says it's just business and like it is to a certain extent, but it's like you can't really have it be 100% business, especially in the arts. It's just not gonna happen. Mm.
Yeah.
There's too much heart, too much heart and passion in it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. We have to talk about, I sent you this picture, but I just want to show it to you again. This picture of Anne.
Anne, what is she wearing?
Okay. So she has,
is she wearing cardigan?
Of course.
Yeah, it's a cardigan.
Oh yes. And a big window pane plaid shirt. Yes. Love it.
And we noticed it because the pink in her plaid matches the pink on her cardigan. And it was the most like seamless thing. For those of you who aren't listening, I'll post this on Instagram. But or who aren't watching, I mean to say, I'll post it on Instagram. But I was like, oh my gosh, how did that work? Did those two come together? Like, do you remember anything about it?
I can't say I remember anything about it, but as you pulled it up, I remember that shirt positively. Yeah. And those things just work out.
Yeah.
And luckily, Rashida is so gorgeous. It's funny because people do love her clothes, but I think they also love her in them.
Mm-hmm.
And she is really fun to dress. And she, as gorgeous as she is, manages to be girl next door at the same time and mm-hmm. play best friend. And she's incredible.
That's amazing. Well, and I mean, what we were talking about too, is as far as her being more professional in this City Hall workspace now, is so different than just wearing scrubs or just being at her house kind mm-hmm. of vibe. Even when she's in her house, though, she has really great clothes. And there was this one scene when she was at her house giving Leslie some clothes from her closet, and all her clothes were so sexy.
Just the pretty woman dress.
You go, Anne. Yeah, the pretty woman dress. Do you remember that part?
Yes, yes. Oh, you're just reminding me, though. Yes, yes, that's very funny. Because I do think Anne ends up being girl next door, and I think every woman, or, you know, woman that isn't a Kardashian lover, is, loves Anne Perkins.
Like, yeah.
She just gets to be cute.
Yeah.
Yep.
She's a
cute meat.
And well-rounded, I feel. Yeah.
Well-rounded. Is that what you said, Holly? Well-rounded?
Yeah.
Yeah, because she puts on this, when you put her next to Leslie, she's like this strong best friend, I'm ready to keep Leslie grounded person, right? And you're like, oh, she's so put together. And then you put her in front of a guy she feels awkward around, and you're like, oh my gosh, she's human. Like, right. So cool. Because you're like, that's how awkward I am. So.
Right.
Yeah.
I think that's why this show is so loved, because every person is so relatable. And if you had to pick someone you're like, you would have a hard time, because we all even have Jerry moments, and we all have Donna moments and Tom moments. And, you know, regardless of what you think, like, there is empathy written for, you know, you can empathize with every single person.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then I wanted to also ask about the times when Anne is dressing for who she's dating, essentially. Oh, yeah. And she wears like a cowboy situation.
Yes.
And she wears like a tracksuit and all these things. And I was just curious if you have any memory of what that was like, or if you've made anything for that, or even just for Anne in general, if you remember making anything.
I forgot all about that episode. I love that episode. And I think it's very relatable, because if you're dating, you want to be appealing to the person you're going out. I mean, it just makes so much sense. And I think we all do it to a certain extent. It's not like, you know, if you know that the person is into hiking or whatever, you might not wear your stilettos. You know, you are always trying. I mean, I don't have the courage enough to go to a party where everyone is in a cocktail dress and sweatpants. You know, I want to disappear in the party a bit.
Yeah.
And she's not disappearing at all, but just that idea to try to fit in with, and it's funny, just thinking about dating, you are trying to like
meld and mesh together. Meld,
yes. But then when do you become authentic again? You know, when.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I think that's well done with her, though, right? Because she has that phase. She goes with Chris, and then everybody that she kind of dates. And in the end, when she ends up with Chris, she's still wearing everything Anne was wearing when she was single.
Mm-hmm.
So it's this really nice ending for her.
Right. That she gets to be her most herself. Mm-hmm.
Totally.
And
you
she didn't go.
For her? Or was it more of
we definitely vibe? Made things for her, but I can't off the top of my head. It's been so many years.
I know. And there's so many costumes. I mean, come on.
We make so many things.
Yeah.
And I work with the same seamstress that I did back in Parks and Rec.
Okay.
Creation. Hello, Monina.
Monina!
Who is so talented. And... That's amazing. She makes, She's the best.
That's really nice to hear about the team too, because I was going to ask you about like the seamstress or like the sewing skills that like, do you bring that anything like that to the table as far as your skill set goes? Because I feel like you don't necessarily need it, or do you? I don't know.
Some costume designers are excellent tailors and some of us are not. I think that sometimes it can get in your way because I'm not afraid to ask for something. It's funny. If I started to direct, I think I would have so much empathy for the costume department. I think like, I can't ask for a football team tomorrow, you know, yeah. Where other people don't know what you'd have to, with the hoops you'd have to jump through to get there. Yeah. And with Monina, I just go in there and I think, and I say like, I want it to be like this and like this and like this. And, you know, kind of, we're both drawing pictures and showing, you know, what we kind of the vision to try to make something. And
yeah,
I think I ask for a little more than I should. And I always get it because I'm not quite sure what it's going to take for her to get there. Mm-hmm. And that's maybe not a nice thing to say, because what I'm saying is she works harder for me because I, but I do think we can push a little bit up against each other and we always come up with something amazing.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's awesome.
Is the sketches something that you feel like is a strength too? Or is it more of like, here's just kind of an outline? Because sketching stuff, from what I've seen, not that I know a bunch, that looks like insane too, just from a sketch and then bringing it to life, you know?
Yeah. My sketches look like... maybe a fourth grader did them. My son says I'm an outliner, but I, okay. You know, because he went to art school. He, you know, you don't draw from the outside in, but I do.
Yeah.
So he's, you know, if I'm drawing a body, I.
You gotta have an outline.
But anyway, if you can show more or less, it's funny because I have. Like a superhero costume. I once drew like talking to the producer on the phone and how it went from my drawing to the sketch artist to, you know,
yeah.
Several of my drawings to the sketch artist. And, you know, mine looks so goofy and they eventually.
No, but that's how it works though. The collaborations too. And I mean, have you ever had to work with like those, because I watch it, you know, obviously I watch a lot of behind the scenes making of type of things for everything. And I've seen those like 3D kind of sketches or what you would see on the computer once it's like goes from sketch to the online thing. Do you have to do much of that in the shows that you work on? Or is that more of like a movie period piece type thing, or you know what I mean?
I mean, you can do it or not do it. Everybody has a different way of doing it. I feel every once in a while.
Yeah.
I do it. And I don't have to do it on every show. Definitely not. And especially when you're doing contemporary.
Okay.
I think that a lot of like futuristic things and maybe for Amy's wedding dress, for Leslie Knope's wedding dress, mm-hmm. I might have sketched what the length that I wanted it to be and how we were going to connect all the folds, those ideas. But we're moving so fast. It's not that in television. If you have a week to prep something and build something, you're not spending one day drawing it. And that's how much time it takes. And so, of course, over the years, I've had to draw things and take things from drawing to camera.
Yeah.
But we're moving rapid fire. Mm-hmm. And it's shorthand. And it means that I'm probably in with the seamstress more than somebody else who just did the perfect drawing. It means that I'm kind of checking it and figuring it.
Yeah, that makes sense.
We're just operating in a different way in television, mostly.
Okay, that makes total sense. I didn't even think about the time it would take to make those two. For mm-hmm. sure. Okay, I have a deep cut question. I don't know if you'll remember it, but or even if a lot of the fans will remember it. But I have to ask if you remember the divorce horse. Which is basically this big horse that comes in and does a telegram to Leslie and Ron. It's just this big, huge horse mascot costume.
Oh, vaguely. That's very funny.
I mean, I think it was in like the end of season two, maybe. So I don't even.
No, I'm sure I did it. But yeah, we did a lot of those walkabouts and we did build those. We, you know, when there were like the weird lady that was looked like a bird and an eggshell, all of that we built. We built Jerry's giant coffee, you know, when he was like a coffee pot. Yes. And those things we did build from scratch because they're very specific and they don't exist out in the, you can't order them from Amazon.
Right.
Mm-hmm. A horse costume, you can. I'm sure we ordered parts of that and then made parts of it. And that's generally what we're kind of doing to move that quickly. We get some kind of base and then we make it our own.
Got it. Okay.
But like, say the coffee pot, we had a week to build it and it was crazy, but you know, with some foam and some spray paint, some crafty women, you can, and men, but
totally.
Our team is mostly women. Yeah.
Yeah. And are you having like meetings with your team pretty much every week to say like, you do this, and, or is it more of like on the job, like on the fly kind of thing?
I would say we have meetings every day.
Okay.
We are, I mean, all our offices are next to each other and I still to this day sit across from Alexis. She doesn't do every job with me, but many.
Yeah.
And so oddly, my view is the same as Parks and Rec, my beautiful Alexis Jackson's face.
Yeah.
And wait, what's the point? Oh, do we? Yes, like we meet every day. We're talking every day. And I'm obsessed with calendars, big giant calendars on the wall, which is like a joke in my office because I'm always staring at the calendar and thinking like, when are we prepping this? When does that work? You know, because you're trying to figure out when that works, what to put the gas on, you know, when to step on it and when you can kind of break for something else.
Totally. I mean, those deadlines must be so important too, because if shooting day is, and then you don't have like an outline, then you're just like,
ah. And you try to stay ahead of it. And we really do, because I've had the same team for so, you know, on so many different shows. I have a very big crew because doing multiple shows. So not every person on this crew worked on Parks and Rec. Maybe they worked on Up All Night, or maybe they worked on Lady Dynamite, or maybe they worked on something.
Yeah.
You should watch Lady Dynamite. It's so funny.
Okay,
Maria Bamford. She's so funny.
I know. I follow her on Instagram. She's a great follow.
She's hilarious. She's awesome. But, you know, so people came from all different places, but a lot of them came from Parks.
Gotcha. And are you, I'm sorry, I feel like I have questions every time you tell me something new. I'm like,
fascinating.
Okay. Do you hire these people or is it like the director that's hiring, or are you kind of like putting the crew together?
I'm putting the crew together. And Alexis is putting the crew together. She's my partner in crime for sure. So we talk about who works best with who, you know, how it's all going to play out. You know, we're also a small family within a family.
Yeah. Totally.
And we're together a lot. And I think I have such, I can't remember any time where I didn't love every one of them. And, you know, we used to have potlucks all the time. They are the best. And a lot of the women that work for me started out as PAs with me.
Okay.
So then we get them into the union and they move up and now they're all doing different things that they like to do, but a lot of them are still working for me.
Okay. Well, that's so
working
cool.
With me, not
yes.
For me.
With and for
I work for them.
That's amazing. Okay.
And in some ways I do, I have to say, because I take jobs to keep them working.
Literally, yes. I mean, total, and I'm sure they're so grateful to be able to kind of have that family, because I know having a job in any business, company, whatever, is always like, this is the boss and then I'm the employee kind of vibe. So it's nice to be able to have a community with it too.
Right. And we spend a lot of hours together. So we have to be, you know, at this, you do you become friends. They become like daughters to me.
Yeah, it sounds like the writer's room, honestly, but it's a costume room or a wardrobe room.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay. I have a quick question about April, because Maddie and I talked about this, where we saw that she was very gothic, you know, starting out very dry kind of sense. But we have seen after, not just because, but I think she's becoming more confident, but also now she's with Andy, and she, especially in season 4, has such more vibrant colors. Like literally the last episode of season 3, she was still in like this dark navy cardigan thing. And then the following episode, she's in this very bright, like reddish vibe shirt. And it's just such a different April. And I was wondering if you remember if that was a conscious decision for wardrobe for her.
I think we wanted to, I'm not a big fan of putting dark colors on these kind of TV shows, because I think when you're wearing black, for instance, it kind of creates a hole in the film. You know, it's like your eye goes to it. But I do think Aubrey was game to do a little bit of a switch up, and you don't need to dress her goth. Her, her expressions and her character spoke for themselves. We didn't. So at that point, we were making her cute. She was dating, and we went a little sweeter with her.
Yeah, you can.
But
totally
she
tell.
Still has her attitude.
Yes,
and she still does today. Did either of you see her movie Emily?
No, Emily, I know what you're talking about. Unarrested. No. In Crime? Emily? No.
Oh my gosh.
I forgot what
it
is.
We have to get it. No, we have to get it.
I'll look it up.
I'll look it up. I won't. I will look it up. You look it up.
Okay. Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about, and it won a ton of things. Emily the Criminal.
Emily the Criminal. She's so good in it. I'm so proud of her, because
me too.
I've known her, I feel like, since she was a kid. And now she's married and she's so successful, and we are all rooting for her, you know.
Yeah, totally.
She's like all of us, Rashida, Amy, like our little kid that is like.
She has so much blossomed. I mean, everybody in the show has, truly, really.
Mm-hmm. Look at Chris Pratt.
Oh my gosh.
Insane.
What an
example.
He must
have been easy to dress with, like, plaid shirts.
Plaid shirts, and also his work look, which was hilarious. You know, when he started wearing his tie.
Yes, and the short sleeve collar shirts. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. That's amazing. I also took a picture of, I think I might have sent this to you in the email, but I took a picture of Tammy too, because I always love her, Megan Mullally. I just love her crazy hats. And crazy outfits in general. Like, she has such an Easter Sunday vibe, but like dark Easter Sunday.
Oh, yeah. She is dark, Black Sunday for sure.
Black Sunday. Yeah.
She's hilarious, as you know. Mm-hmm. And it's funny, because I was thinking about the wedding dress episode, and I was flashing to shooting, and I can't remember which order, but we were. Amy, does she get Ron out of jail with Tammy in that wedding dress?
Oh, yeah, she does. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep.
So I was thinking, it just came to me, because I remember we were on the east side somewhere at some jail, some old jail. And, you know, we were in that. That's the first time that wedding dress worked on set.
Right.
I'm sure that's not how the show laid out, but
yeah, and then
with
Megan Mullally,
Ron in a, yeah, Megan was there, and I think Ron was in a, I think Nick was in a kimono.
Yep, that's it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My memory is working. Tammy too was so fun. It was so much fun. Didn't we have her in the back of a car also? We were always doing wacky things, and Megan is so game.
Mm-hmm. Well, I feel like you guys had a good balance of making the Black Sunday Tammy too, but also the librarian Tammy too, because she has nice cardigans and stuff in some episodes as well. Yeah. You know? Yeah. So I thought that was really interesting. And I just was curious as far as, did you know like what her whole vibe was going to be? Or was it more of so you just read the script and you were like, let's just give her some crazy shit?
No, I think I'm sure I knew what the vibe was going to be. I'm sure. And I mean, we always wanted to have a little fun with the crazies.
Mm-hmm. Totally. I mean, were there any like crazy malfunctions or any weird memories that like stick out to you from the show?
I wish I talked to you 10 years ago, because I'm sure there were. I would say maybe Amy's pregnancy sometimes made us hustle a bit.
Sure.
Just because I never wanted, you know, I was always watching the screen praying that you wouldn't see Abel poking through the belly.
We couldn't see him.
It's so funny because he's such a tall, gorgeous young man now to think about that.
Yeah.
I don't know. Not off the top of my head.
Well, if anything comes to you, I mean, you have my info.
Yeah, I do.
Well, and as far as like speaking of pregnancies, because Maddie brought up too that Anne was pregnant at one point during, not like in real life, at least as far as I know, but did she must have had like a baby bump situation going on. Like, was that something that you had to work around?
And is that something you're in charge of, the bump?
Right.
Or is that
yes? Props? No, I'm in charge of the bump. And I'm sure we got it, and it was very easy with Rashida. I'm sure it wasn't. We've done it a million times. That is something that is TV 101 or movie, whatever, film 101, to put those baby bumps on people. The much harder thing to do is hide, to play not pregnant when you are pregnant, which happens.
Interesting.
And on every show.
Yeah.
Every show, the actress calls me and says, guess what? No.
Like, I'm so happy for you, but also my job.
Could you have waited?
Exactly. It's much easier when Andy Samberg says, my wife is pregnant.
Oh, yes. God. I know, which kind of sucks because it's like, I don't know. I kind of wish that they could somehow write that in so it's not as hard or not as like frowned upon to have that or like have other options, because I know that fashion is so hard for bigger people. I mean, me speaking as a size 16, 18, like I can't go in a lot of stores. I have to go online because I can't try stuff on. And a lot of times like fittings with are not like, I haven't had terrible experiences, but like people look, I think I wear it well. People look at me and give me smaller sizes. And I'm just like, thank you, baby girl. But that's not what it, no. So, and then they'll try to like squeeze me into something. And I'm just like, there has to be another option, you know? And I know that's not like pregnancy, but there's just a lot of like red tape, I think, that you have to think about and work around, you know?
Right, right. Amy always would tell me at the end when we were coming back for the next season, she'd say, she was like, make sure you don't give me any small pants. Like,
they're gonna give rip.
Me. Well, just no. not that they're going to rip. It's like, I don't want to try on clothes that are too small for me. Mm-hmm. Like, you know what I mean? That makes you feel crappy.
Mm-hmm.
Like you want people to get your sizes right.
And yeah. Well, and it's so hard too, because the sizing is so different from store to store. That's the hardest part.
Completely. So what you do when you know is you say, you're a X size wear, you know, and then once you have that, you can map out what size you'd be every other place, you know?
Yeah. That makes sense. I mean, and have you had like super long fittings before where you like couldn't find something, or is it more so like, we'll just make it work and you just are collaborating the whole time?
I feel like we're collaborating the whole time, and I feel like I have long enough discussions with people before they come.
That's key.
Mm.
And, you know, I'm going to mispronounce Jana's last name, Schmeling. I'm going to say your name wrong, so I'm not going to say it.
Okay.
But anyway, where that if somebody says they have something, a difficult body to fit, you would
talk to them.
To, ask them to bring in something that you might be able to pattern. So that if you have a favorite dress, you Holly, and you were like, oh, I wish I had this dress in more fabrics. Yeah. It looks so good on me, this silhouette. I would try to build things from what you already know. Mm. I mean, I also try to take people know their bodies. Yeah. It's helpful to.
That's smart.
Yeah. Ask people what they actually want to wear and what actually looks good on them.
Yeah, totally. That makes sense. And hopefully that they're like honest about it. Cause I'm sure also some people like have never had to think about that, you know, until they're like specifically asked, cause every body is different, you mm-hmm. know?
Yes.
Yeah. That makes total sense. Yes. And we've talked a lot about the women's outfits, but I mean, is there anything, I feel like the dudes are just kind of easy-ish. I mean, like Adam Scott was probably like really the only one that I could imagine character-wise different because of the cardigans and the ties.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he was fun and very specific. And so the more specific somebody is, the easier it is. You know, you see the thing, you see the item and you know it's them. But I would say Aziz had Tom Haverford.
Oh, that's
Aziz
true.
Aziz had
and John Ralphio. Great,
yeah. And John Ralphio and his twin. And, you know, we had so much fun with John Ralphio especially, but also Aziz. And he's very fashionable in his own life. Mm-hmm. And so he's fun to dress because he cares. Mm. And I think we really cleaned out his first season closet pretty quickly. Mm-hmm. Like, and I think that was Mike also writing to the fact that Aziz himself cares about clothes. And so eventually Tom Haverford cares about clothes.
Definitely. Yeah. Oh my gosh. The way he mentions like Tom Ford and Tommy Hilfiger and all these like high end things. But mm-hmm. we can totally see also when he starts his Entertainment 720 business in that season where he like is not wearing the tie anymore. His like chest hairs are open.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, he's fun because he loves it. So he wants to wear panda sneakers and he wants to do it.
Yeah.
That's so funny.
He's so funny. I mean, on that note, you know, he was always on his phone initially. And then they did that whole episode where he was always on his phone.
Yeah.
You know, and he cared about fashion. And then we dove into him, his character caring about fashion. So that just another love note to Mike is that he definitely made it so that people were kind of melding mm-hmm. in a good way with their characters.
Yeah. Was there like a favorite place that you have to shop for wardrobe or like your go-to?
That place is gone and it's called Barney's of New York.
Oh, dang it.
R.I.P. And I wouldn't say that's where I shop for people for that lived in Pawnee.
Fair.
But my personal favorite store where like, you know, there's breakfast at Tiffany's, I would say lunch at Barney's. Like I felt very relaxed in there. I felt like nothing bad can happen to me in Barney's.
Aw. Wait, Barney's is gone now? What do you mean?
Barney's is gone. Barney's is
forever?
Gone.
It stopped? Like everywhere?
It stopped. Saks bought up the name and has like a floor in their store that is called Barney's, but it's not Barney's at all.
Oh, dang.
Yeah, Barney's in New York closed. And
I did not know
Did you say you moved to New York? You didn't move to New York. Where are you?
I'm in Nashville now, but I was in Nashville. LA for a while. Nashville. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Okay. And so wait, is Barney's like your personal favorite one or is that also where you go for a lot of costumes too?
It's my personal. And also, you know, when Aziz started getting really wacky things like those panda shoes were Jeremy Scott, I think for Adidas. And, okay. You know, you can only find those kinds of things at that, you know, there were places where you could go to shop for him specifically.
Right. Well, and speaking of that, I mean, when he opens up Tommy's closet or whatever it is, like, was that you guys or was that prop that was figuring out which clothes he was going to put in that store?
both. We definitely give a few things that might be iconic, but props fills the store and they get credit for that. We only give a little cherry on the sundae.
Okay, gotcha. I mean, it's just
on those kind of things. Yeah.
And like those little details as far as like Ron's like red sex shirt Tiger Woods. I mean, writing that in must be like such a gift to be told like this is what the thing is. And now you have to just fill in the blank, you know?
Yes. Yes. Everything was a gift. There was always a present in every script. Also, yeah, oh definitely. My
God. I love that. And I can't wait to get to where Amy is in city council, because right now she's just running for it. Mm-hmm. And I feel like it just changes so, like, as even with her hair and everything, everything just looks so clean. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, and yeah. I like her dark stuff too, like her navy blue stuff as well.
Yes, she looks so good. Wait, so you're going through episode by episode. So you're on episode, which number are you on?
We just finished season 4, episode 2, the Ron and Tammy. So we just met Tammy 1.
So what number are you on? I think we made 124, did we? Episodes?
Ooh, I don't know.
Oh, you don't know what?
My head.
Right.
I should know that, but I don't.
I mean, I should know that. Guesstimate. Because there's 6 in the first season, like 22 in the second.
Yeah.
So 28 plus 22 again.
I mean, 24 50. Episodes is insane. Like, I can't remember. Like,
it doesn't happen anymore. It doesn't happen.
Like, that is so wild to me. I'm speaking of the hours and stuff, which, by the way, you were just showing your son that you are a hardworking mom. Okay. So that was
nice. Thank you. And Amy, too. And we have that, you know, that we wanted to be working moms. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
And yeah, I will say I'm so happy that I was a working mom. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, totally. Do you just have one son or more than one kid?
One son.
Okay, gotcha.
He's graduating from NYU.
Oh, my God, that's so exciting.
16th. Yeah.
Congratulations. What did
he study? Thank you.
Was he the art designer? No.
He was in art. He's doing the aesthetics of politics. He gets to make up his own major because he goes to a school called Gallatin.
Okay.
So I don't know what that means, and I don't know what he's going to do.
Okay.
But, let's see. Art and political movements. That's okay. The
interesting.
That's the lowdown. Yeah.
I'd be intrigued to see what he does with that. That will be great.
Yeah, let's see.
I mean, there is art in political movements, like Obama's poster. Hello.
Yes.
Lots of stuff going on. And I mean, we're talking about it now.
Lots of buzz. Leslie's outfits. Exactly. All the murals in Pawnee.
Yep. Oh, my gosh. Of course. Yes. We did talk to, oh, my gosh, I'm going to forget his name. This is so awful. Jeff Massa. I believe is his name.
Oh, yeah.
He's the art director. Yes. And he's worked on, I think he's worked on a couple of other things with Mike Schur as well.
Yes, yes.
But that's just one person in the, like, huge crew of Parks. So it's really lovely to me to hear about the, like, set design, too, because that whole, like, the bullpen and everything just, and the way that they have the courtyard on the set to make it seem like they're outside. Mm-hmm. It's so beautiful.
Yeah, it is. The birds in there.
Oh my God, the pigeons.
We're obsessed with the pigeons.
We talk about them all the time.
Oh, so am I. I'm so obsessed with the pigeons. And maybe that's where my pigeon obsession started. Because I collect, and I also live in New York. And in New York, I have paper mache pigeons everywhere.
Oh my God. Totally. Some
been
of them
collecting.
Are real, some of them aren't real in the show.
Yes.
So it's like, which one's real?
Yeah.
That's cool that you collect those. I'm sure that's a fun collection.
It is. I think so.
Awesome. Well, do you have any other like memories that are just like popping off the top of your head or any crazy things that you can think of?
I don't know, anyway? But I do think that I just will say that I love the show, that it changed my life, that I made some of the best friends in my adult life at Parks and Recreation. Yes.
Love that.
Well, you've changed our lives. So
yes.
And I thank you too. Thank you too. I'll call you for therapy later and just for chatting later.
Yes. Well, one of the questions are one of our wrap up questions that we have though, is if you could relate to any character in the show, who would you relate the most to? You can pick top three if you need to, because sometimes it's hard.
I know. It's funny. Let's think about this, because you initially just go straight to the women, right? So, and I feel like every woman knows the Leslie Knope in herself, you know, the person that is trying so hard and working so hard and going up against something again and again. Mm-hmm. But I also feel I relate to Anne, that she's, I think, the friend portion of her. Mm-hmm. I do think that if cast in this life, I'm cast as friend, not as lead.
I like it.
Lead character energy is real though. So we can manifest, but also everybody needs a friend. Yeah. So
everybody needs a friend. I think I might be sidekick. I don't know if what that says about me or that I picked that for myself.
Well, it's almost feels a bit life.
Lazy. No, I'm saying in my own life, I'm the
sidekick.
I'm the friend.
I'm the sidekick, giving you lead character.
The third wheel, you know, I'm that guy.
No. Oh my gosh. Well, all of these shows would not be the same without you. So, I mean, look, yeah. Everybody also does need a sidekick. So, I mean, it's not a bad place to be.
Right. Maybe I am, you know, I'm definitely. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, Batman wouldn't be Batman without Robin. Who are we kidding?
No kidding.
Harry Potter would not have survived a day in his life without Hermione.
Oh,
like,
yeah,
are you
never.
Kidding me? Like,
never.
Never, ever.
Well, Hermione's the lead, isn't she?
Yeah, right. Come on now. Yeah.
That's what I'm saying, too.
They both would have been dead.
Are totally.
Yeah, they needed. Yes,
sidekicks
exactly.
Sidekicks are like that energy surrounding sidekicks should definitely be taken away. Well, let's remove that because they would, the leads, quote unquote leads, would not, like, whatever. They're just.
Whatever.
They're
whatever.
The pretty face.
Yes,
they're
yes, not, yes.
Although, well, Queen, I will say, is the lead character of everything. So, Queen
is,
Goddess, mother of everything.
She is. But. As a friend, she will be a sidekick to you if you need to lead.
Yeah.
She's that good of a friend.
Oh, that's amazing. I love that so much. Mm-hmm. Maddie, did you have any other questions or things that I forgot to say?
No, I think I got to ask all of my questions. I'm much more of a listener. I like to just listen and soak everything up. So
I think you got the right job.
Yes.
Being a therapist. You never want a talkie therapist.
This is true. I've had those. It's not great.
Mm-hmm. I always want my therapist to tell me what to do, like exactly what to do. That's
me
so not
too.
The job, but like I want them to be like, no, you need to do this immediately.
Me too. I want like a mother for rent.
Yeah.
Like, kind of a bossy mom that isn't like my mom.
Right.
Right.
Because my mom will boss, but I want, you know.
I know like the therapist creed is to like guide your clients to what they need to do, but I'm just like, can you just tell me and like speed this along?
Exactly. Okay, Maddie, do you ever really know what someone should do and you're just sitting there like sitting on your hands like, oh, I can't tell them they should just leave that husband or whatever.
So I
like in Shrinking. Oh my God. You guys have to watch Shrinking.
I haven't seen it yet.
I've got to see it. You will both love it because that's what he does. But anyway, go ahead.
Yeah. So I do less the sit in an office and just listen to you vent and then give the slight guidance. I do less of that, and I work with a lot of kids that are on the autism spectrum. That's where my passion is. And then I work with counseling their family into how do you better support your kid. So I do a lot of direct conversation. That's not always fun. Do you see what your child is doing right now? They are screaming for this without screaming for this. So you have to do this or this behavior is not going to change. So that's, I do a lot of very direct in your face work. And I have told someone, you probably shouldn't be dating that person, to a parent. And should I have? Maybe not. But it was in the kid's best interest.
I love that. I think that is what I'd want. I'd want somebody to just say, like, stop.
Yeah.
You, what are you doing? But I guess we all have to figure it out on our own time.
I know.
In our own time.
I know.
That's true, Holly, huh? We learn that all the time together.
I know. That's been the mantra lately. It's like the universe's timing is not my timing, and it sucks. But, you know, whatever. No. But yeah, seriously, watch Shrinking on Apple TV. Jason Segel is phenomenal. It's the same like casting crew and producers and stuff. Not cast, but a lot of the crew is Ted Lasso. And that combination that they have of combining the deep with the funny is just flawless. It's so good.
Oh, I cannot wait.
Yes.
I cannot wait.
Oh my gosh. Well, Kirston, thank you so for being with us
today. Thank you, guys. Thank you. So much fun. Such a fun way to spend my Sunday.
Yay. Yes.
You're both very easy to talk to.
Thank you.
If you see Alan, tell him hi. Tell him we love him and tell him to reach out to me immediately.
And Mike Sure. I mean, it wouldn't hurt either.
I mean, Alan Yang and Rob Lowe, I know they have their own podcast, but I think they've taken a pause just because of all the stuff they're working on. Mm-hmm. I know Rob Lowe has his own show. So if they would like us to take over, listen.
I did do their show initially because I was working with Alan at the time.
Yeah.
I couldn't be too busy because he knew exactly what I was doing.
Right, exactly. You're like, you know my schedule, so I can't lie.
It's a little intimidating, but it was so much fun. Good. Yeah, they're good. So cute. Both of them are so sweet.
Yeah.
Like you too. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me. Yeah.
Have a good Sunday. We'll see you soon.
Happy Sunday.
Bye.
There's a Parkinson Pals and there's also therapy too.